if Muslims listened to Allah, they wouldn't suffer the timetables headache. Each masjid with different timetables, then people complain, which should I follow? And I always answer, follow your window. What I mean by that is follow the Quran. Then Allah says, ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ, then you complete your psalm until the night fall. وَلَا تُبَاشِرُوهُنَّ وَأَنْتُمْ عَاكِفُونَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ, and do not have sex with your wives or your partners or your wives while you are secluded in the masjid. And this is obvious because the masjid is not the place for sex. And also when you are doing your i'tikaf or you are secluding yourself in the masjid, you have a purpose and a goal to accomplish. Sex is not one of them. So having sex in the masjid is very inadequate. And if Allah had told this at the time when the Quran was revealed, that's because there were people who wanted either to do it or who did part of it, or but Allah did reveal that for a purpose, and that purpose is it existed at that time. The rule is no sex while in i'tikaf in the masjid, and that's that. Then Allah says, تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ فَلَا تَقْرَبُهَا, those are the limits of Allah, so approach them not. I.e., if who doesn't fast is the person who's sick or traveling. From where to fast? From day sunrise to night. And whatever Allah mentioned in this ayah, these are the rules of Allah. Do not approach them. You know what we did? Not only did we approach them, we changed them, we ignored them, we invented other rules of our own, and now we are fasting Ramadan on our terms and conditions. But anyhow, these limits here, we need to go back to the Quran and derive them. Then Allah says, كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ آيَاتِهِ لِلنَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ. And for this, what Allah has explained in these four ayat, it is Allah making His ayat, the Quran, clear evidence to mankind so that they would reach the piety that Allah promised in Ramadan if we fasted according to how He sees it. But what did we Muslims do? What did we do? Well, we left Allah and whatever He said, and we added laws from our own sources, and a simple act of worship, that is fasting Ramadan, don't eat day night, throughout the day, and don't eat and don't drink and don't fornicate, and guess what? We created a lot of things until the whole issue became a headache, an ongoing headache, along with zakat and all. The way Allah legislated the fasting of Ramadan makes it really simple, beautiful, and easy to follow. It shows the easiness that Allah speaks of and promised and He wanted for us. But when you look at what humans, those righteous predecessors, wrote about Ramadan, you will develop the greatest headache you can possibly have. Pages upon pages upon pages of arguments, opinions, views, hadiths, and whatnot. And all these were to drive anyone who studies them into an abyss of never-ending confusion and misery. And this pretty much describes the state of Muslims whenever Ramadan approaches. So anyone who follows what Allah says in the Quran shall have an easy fasting. And whoever takes the other path, then they will have a hard and confusing fast. Ladies and gentlemen, make your choices and you make them now. Notice that Allah only spoke or speaks about food, drink, and sex during the daytime of Ramadan. He did not speak about perfume. He did not speak about taking a bath. He did not speak about shower or daytime, brushing your teeth or hugging your partner for emotional support or expression, but not for sex, obviously, or applying henna or makeup or have manicure or pedicure or walk naked in the house or what. Allah spoke about three definite things: food, water, and sex. Such that all the other extras are nothing else but human additions that have complicated again an easy act of worship beyond recognition. From the Quran is simple. Don't deliberately eat, don't deliberately drink, and do not deliberately have sex, and that's it. As for the timing of the fasting, it really is simple. You should carry on eating and drinking and sexing, if that is correct, till you see the thread of light. When you see it in the horizon from your own window, then you stop. And when Allah says you, it means you. And He's talking to you, not somebody else. When all Muslims, my dear sisters and brothers, follow this simple divine command, then no one will ever disagree with another person, because each person knows that the other person is following the Quran, and that's that, finished. No more confusion, no more school of thoughts, no more this hadith is Bukhari and that hadith is Muslim. Now back to the menstruation death row, so to speak. From what we saw, menstruation women are perfectly entitled to fast, and if a lady sees that her menstruation cycle has started during daytime or 5 minutes before Maghrib or any time throughout the day, she absolutely carries on fasting as if nothing has happened. It's just her body getting rid of a piece of blood, just like you get some blood coming out of your nose, and that's that. So where did the fatwa that women must not fast come from? Because we need to understand, because understanding where this comes from will help us not only get the true knowledge about this issue, but also it will open up a window of opportunity to find out how are we practicing Islam. And before answering this extremely important yet overlooked question, I want to say this, and I will put it as simply as I can. When Allah didn't exempt menstruating women in the Quran from fasting, He did that just like as He didn't exempt anyone else who vomits. Allah didn't say, if you vomit, do this, if you don't vomit, don't do that. Okay? Because Allah knows that you understand when you vomit, you don't take back your vomit, because if you take it back, that's considered eating. So you're going to throw it away and end of it. So Allah expects from you a certain level of intelligence. Just like Allah didn't mention, if you go to the toilet, it affects your salat, because it's not at all in the equation. The same thing, my dear sisters and my brothers. Because the fast of a woman, a menstruating woman, is not affected in any way by what happens to her physically. Allah didn't exempt the bleeding soldier. He didn't exempt anyone else. Even if you go for local anesthesia operation, and they open you up and they do their operation forever, and then they sew you back on, you don't lose your fast. And you are not excluded. The same thing. And my question that I am dying to ask those righteous predecessors: what exactly that happens to woman that makes her break her fast? Why? What's the reasoning behind it? But Allah only exempted again the sick who can or cannot fast. And as soon as you are sick, then you are totally entitled, fast or don't fast. You see what I mean? If you have a toothache that started at night, and the next day you want to fast, you don't want to fast, entirely up to you. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about, and it is the truth, and He kept His words up. Islam is easy. He promised an easy religion, and He delivered. What He has legislated, what He legislates now, is truly done with easiness, compassion, and the distancing from hardship. I don't say in mind, but you understand what I'm saying here. Is He kept that in view. It was honored. It's a deal. It's a promise Allah made to us, and He kept that promise on. Every time there is a difficulty in your Islam, then know Allah is not the one that imposed that difficulty upon you. All right, so that is really simple. So let me give you a couple of examples here. Yeah, you don't eat and you don't drink and you don't sex. Simple and beautiful, right? Then you base your fast on these three conditions, and let them run. Don't eat, don't drink, don't sex. Let them run your life. Anything that can act as a substitute to one of the three, then they will take the ruling of the original. What I mean by that, for example, if someone suffers from asthma and they use the inhaler, well, the inhaler is neither a food nor a drink, and it's not a sex. And as such, the person can use the inhaler all day long, and it won't affect their fast. Beautiful, right? And that's what it is. And the same applies to medical injections that carry medicines to the body. They are not food, they are not drink, and they are not sex. That's fine. Do them. However, if one injects a serum, and that serum takes nutrition to the body, but intravenously, like it's through your veins, then that serum is considered nutrition, right? Well, it takes the nutrient of food. Cigarettes, are they a drink? They are not. Are they sex? They are not. Are they nutritious? Yes, they are. Due to the ingredients that make up a cigarette, they do nourish the body, even if it is in a smoke form. Because you see, tobacco, you can also chew it. It's a leaf, it's a substance, and it takes the nutrient of a food. Simple. Allah gives you the big title, and anything that is linked to the big title, food, drink, sex, don't do it. Let me give you an example about sex. Before that, if you gargle water, it's hot, or your mouth is dry, and you gargle water in your mouth, but you don't drink it, but it moistens your tongue and your mouth internally and your lips, then that's fine, because that is not considered to drink. You understand? You see? But if you decide to become a fish and spend the whole day inside a sink full of water, that's fine. It's not considered drinking. If you inhale water vapor, it's not drinking. That's fine as well. And that's why women can cook in the kitchen and they can smell the food. And the woman can even taste the food that she cooked with her tongue, because that's not considered food. Beautiful, beautiful. Now, for sex, let's say a woman wears a nice piece of lingerie that gets her or her husband aroused. Then the possibility of an orgasm or that pleasure, sex pleasure, is there. Then she cannot wear that garment, because wearing it leads to sex even at emotional level. Then that acts as having sex. Don't do it. It will ruin your fast. The same thing for a guy. If you wear a piece of clothing that arouses you, or you spend your day salivating and thinking about sex, and the possibility of an enjoyment is there, then you must not wear that garment. Why? Because I sex. Remember, Allah says these are the boundaries of Allah. Do not approach them. Okay? So don't approach it. Beautiful, simple, and everything. These seven examples should help you understand more, and inshallah you get the idea with that. So where does the prohibition for a woman not to fast when menstruation come from? Oh, please pay attention. I will speak about the fast and not the salat for now, as the topic for salat needs another detailed talk to understand this matter. I could have given you this talk in less than 20 minutes and end of it, but my talk is not to teach you what you know. My talk is to give you the other side of the coin. My talk is to reveal to you the Islam that has been hidden from you. The Islam where humans don't manipulate you. The Islam that Allah has promised to deliver the easiness, simplicity. And that kind of Islam is what I do. What I'm doing is not just teaching you what you know or reminding you of what you know. Mine is to entangle all the wrong beliefs and inject new ones from the Quran into you, so that تَحْيَا حَيَاتٍ كَرِيمَ طَيِّبًا, so that you live a happy, beautiful life, another life of misery that we have been living under the manipulation of the hadith and scholars. So now that I have said this and got it off my chest, let's deal with the chief culprits of the evidences that have stopped women from fasting. The chief culprit of this prohibition for women not to fast when menstruation comes from a hadith and opinions of scholars. Scholars whose existence was to serve, again, the respective school of thoughts rather than serving the Quran. Any scholar that you know of today is known to you because that scholar supports the school of thoughts of those people who taught you Islam. That's all there is to it. That's why the Hanafi people, they only know scholars about Hanafism, the Maliki people, they only know scars about this. And Shia, everybody else, the Hanbali, the Wahhabi, you only know Ibn Taymiyyah, because Ibn Taymiyyah is who promoted the Wahhabi, the Hanafi, the Salafist, or what, these people. And these people promote Ibn Taymiyyah. He says, scratch my back, I scratch your back. So the scholars, you know them because the people who taught you Islam want you to know these people, because they want you to take the Islam from these people and not from elsewhere. It's not possible. 1,400 years, you only know about 10 scholars. It doesn't work like that. But anyhow, so that's said. So let's now take a look at the evidences. Hadith number one. There is one hadith that was narrated from different sources, but all these sources meet and converge to one single man. This man's name is Ma'mar. And then after him, the other narrators spread out. What this means is, like a teacher in a classroom, imagine Ma'mar is the teacher, and he has about 20 students. Then the teacher says one thing, and the students take that one thing from him. Then those 20 students will travel to different parts, and they will teach it to different people. So 20 will say, teach it to 10, and then with time you have 200 students that know what that Ma'mar, or that one man, said. And this is the ripple effect that took place before. That's why you hear one hadith and it says, and in another version, it means that one man said one thing and different people heard that whatever he said, and then they took it to different people. Okay, so if the teacher now, here's what the problem is. If the teacher shares something wrong with the students, and you know the Chinese whisper, when someone takes something, adds a little bit, retrieves, and by the end of it, it's changed. Now imagine if the teacher says something wrong, and the students take that something wrong and share it with the world, and you end up with a recipe for disaster. I will just take the hadith reported in Sahih Muslim book, because Al-Bukhari does not mention this hadith. And as you already know, Muslim is the second book in the authenticity of hadith after Al-Bukhari. So by dealing with Muslim, and it will give us a good idea about the rest of the hadith. And we are going to concentrate on this hadith in particular, reported by Ma'mar, because it is this hadith that has caused women not to pray and not to fast. So now let us deal with the chain of narrators. So in Sahih Muslim, the chain of narrators, or students, or those who report the hadith from Ma'mar, goes something like this. حدثنا عبد بن حميد ثقة حافظ. حدثنا, i.e. he directly spoke to us. Also, these terminologies, he directly spoke to us, told us, there is no consensus within the scholar hadith community about their meanings. Each scholar understands them as he sees fit, and that also creates a huge headache. But anyway, حدثنا, i.e. he directly spoke to us, meaning the sheikh gave a talk and the narrator heard it with others. There was no direct supervision. It was not a one-to-one. It's the teacher talking in a classroom. This Abdu ibn Humayd, this guy, was a trustworthy memorizer. That's how they qualify him in the science of hadith. And then they said, أخبرنا عبد الرزاق ثقة حافظ. أخبرنا, he informed us, formal or informal. And people didn't know where he got the news from, but he told them. And Abdul Razzaq is also a trustworthy memorizer. And then he says, أخبرنا Ma'mar. So this Abdul Razzaq heard it from Ma'mar, and he told it to Abd ibn Humayd. And then he goes, أخبرنا Ma'mar, and he is the friend, the companion of Az-Zuhri. Az-Zuhri is a well-respected hadith scholar. And also, Ma'mar is a man on whom the scholars of hadith disagree. They are not sure of him. Is he reliable? Is he not? And as I will explain. Okay? So, but anyhow, this man, Ma'mar, is the weakest link in the chain of narrators, believe it or not. And he is the teacher who taught. Now, go figure. And he is the one who narrated the hadith of women not to have fast, not to fast in Ramadan. Imagine the weakest link tells you women must not fast. And for 1400 years, Muslims have been taking what the weakest link said. But anyway, here is what the expert scholars from the famous 3rd century on the science of hadith say about this man. And we're going to start with the top of them all. You see, before, when they used to, before, here we say PhD, a doctor, a professor, but back then they would name somebody like Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sheikh al-Islam, these huge lofty titles telling you that this man is an infinity, it's the Einstein of hadith, so to speak. His name is Yahya ibn Ma'in. Let me give you a little bit about Yahya ibn Ma'in, because his weight in the hadith community is very heavy, and you need to know about that. And also, I wish any Salafis would hear my talk, so that before answering or before doing anything, they know where I'm coming from, so that they can see with me through eye to eye to what I am saying. Yahya ibn Ma'in is a Persian scholar. He's not an Arab. Notice that in the second dynasty of Al-Abbasiyin, the majority, over 95% of scholars were all Persians. Al-Bukhari is Persian, Muslim is Persian, Ibn Majah is Persian, Al-Nasa'i is Persian, Al-Tirmidhi is Persian, Al-Bazzali is Persian, Al-Bayhaqi is all, every scholar, even Ibn Taymiyyah is not an Arab. Okay? All, as I said, 95% of the scholars that we today consider righteous practices were all of them Persians. And the reason is political, because it was the Iranians, the Persians, that helped the second dynasty of the Abbasiyin against Banu Umayyah. So the Iranians were allies to Bani al-Abbas, who built the second dynasty, in fighting against the Banu Umayyah, and they helped in the murdering and all that kind of stuff. So later on, when the Dawla al-Abbasiyah, the Abbasid dynasty, became powerful, it brought forth all Persians to the forefront, and there you have it. At-Tabari is Persian, and so on to speak. But anyhow, so now we get an idea that it's politics that made these scholars come forward, and the hadith and all that kind of stuff. But anyhow, Ibn Ma'in was born in the year 158 Hijri calendar. So that's 150 years almost after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because you take the 10 years of his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But anyway, and he was still considered as Amir al-Mu'mineen, the highest authority of the believers in the hadith. It's like, as I said, saying that this guy is the president of the scholars of man in the chain of narrators or what have you. He also was a very close friend to Ahmed ibn Hanbal, the founder of the Hanbali, of this extremist part of Islam. Even though this school of thought was started long after the death of Ahmed ibn Hanbal, it's also worth saying that the relationship between these two men, this great man, got severed later on due to the issue between Ahmed and al-Mu'tazila. And of course, Ahmed was absolutely wrong in what he did, but that's how Salafism was founded, and that's how the righteous predecessors was founded. Righteous predecessors basically means those people close to the king, to the politics, to the government. He was also, I'm speaking about Yahya ibn Ma'in, he was born at the time of the king Abu Ja'far al-Mansur. And Abu Ja'far is the guy who asked Malik, Imam Malik, to write his book of hadith, al-Muwatta. And Malik compiled the book of hadith from the people of al-Madinah. And it is Abu Ja'far who asked, or who deputized Ibn Ishaq to write the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you can see this Abu Ja'far al-Mansur has got a lot to answer for on Judgment Day for what he has done. And he is the second direct king of the dynasty who supervised, again, many scholars, books, and the political Islam we have today. Okay? But anyhow, this is just... Yahya ibn Ma'in, this Amir al-Mu'minin, this absolute authority in the science of man, of chain of narrators, was a very close friend to many great scholars, namely Ahmed ibn Hanbal, Ishaq ibn Rahoya or Rahaway, Abu Bakr ibn Abi Shayba, this is a teacher of al-Bukhari, Ahmed ibn Hanbal is a teacher of al-Bukhari, Abu Khaythama, great scholars, and these four great scholars all showed great and huge respect to the greatness of Yahya ibn Ma'in. Yahya ibn Ma'in alayhi rahmatullah was also hugely sought by students, and anyone, if Yahya ibn Ma'in says that man is good, they say that man is good, his hadith is authentic. If this man can voucher for any other person, can voucher for any other person, that say that man's hadith is taken without questioning at all. Anyway, so now into the eyes of the cyclone, as the expression goes. Yahya ibn Ma'in said about Ma'mar, you remember the chain of the guy who reported this hadith, from whom other people reported the hadith, he said his full name is Ma'mar ibn Rashid. His full name is Ma'mar ibn Rashid. إذا حدثك معمر عن العراقيين فخفه. If Ma'mar tells you a hadith, if the people of Iraq tell you a hadith from Ma'mar, then that hadith, take it lightly. And this is a polite word from Yahya ibn Ma'in to say, do not believe and disregard what Ma'mar has said to you. In another narration, another version of what he says, فَخَالِفَ, I go against it. Whatever they, if Ma'mar says that Rasulullah said, go right, Yahya ibn Ma'in tells you, go left. Don't listen to him. Okay, and then he said, except illa an az-Zuhri, except when Ma'mar reports a hadith from az-Zuhri wa Ibn Tawus. Ibn Tawus is another scholar of hadith as well. And then Yahya ibn Ma'in says, fa inna hadithahu anhuma mustaqim. His hadith, when he reports only from two people, from az-Zuhri and Ibn Tawus, his hadith is upright, is straight. Remember also this name az-Zuhri, will get back to it later. So this is in Tariq ibn Abi Khaythama, one of the great scholars of hadith, and also written by Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani in Tahzib al-Tahzib, book also a huge reference. Al-Albani goes to all scholars of hadith, go to this book, Tahzib al-Tahzib, Tahzib al-Kamal, all these kind of books, because that's where they read about the biography and what scholars say about different people in the chain of narrators, and it is what the other scholars say about a particular person that will make a hadith authentic or not. They don't care about if it contradicts the Quran or not. It's just what the other people say about the chain of narrators, and for that, that's it. But so now, as such, when Ma'mar reports from the people of Iraq, don't listen to him, contradict him, ignore, disregard. If he reports from two people, Az-Zuhri and Ibn Tawus, then at that moment there, his hadith is fine. Listen to what Al-Bukhari says. He says something really strange. He goes, ما أعجب حديث معمر عن غير الزهري, i.e. I don't like the hadith of معمر except when he reports from الزهري. Of course, Al-Bukhari would say the same thing as Yahya ibn Ma'in. And then he asks Al-Bukhari, he says, فإنه لا يكاد يوجد فيه حديث صحيح. For there is not a single authentic hadith when معمر reports. i.e. what they say basically, if معمر tells you that he heard the hadith from Az-Zuhri or Ibn Tawus, then his hadith is authentic. If he reports to you the hadith from anyone else on earth, that hadith is not authentic. And this is reported by Shu'ab al-Iman al-Bayhaqi, al-Imam al-Bayhaqi alayhi wa rahmatullah. Now that we know the status of these chief narrators, remember, he is the guy that all other people converged to and took the hadith from, Ma'mar ibn Rashid. Because this hadith that this Ma'mar reports is not something like say good morning or do this. It's about an act of what Allah says women must do. It's about fast and salat. It's not something simple. The seriousness of the problem is huge. So let us see, where did Ma'mar hear the hadith or the statement that prohibits women from carrying the salat? Well, he heard it from somebody called Asim. Asim is from Al-Iraq. and he heard it from him, and this Asim heard it from another lady, her name is Mu'adha. So the chain of narrators goes like this, and Mu'adha is a companion, as they would call her. The hadith should go like this: Mu'adha, a woman, told Asim, or Asim heard it from Mu'adha, and then Ma'mar heard it from Asim, and then the rest of the chain goes up there. So there is one lady, there is Asim, and then there is Ma'mar. So Ma'mar did not hear it from Az-Zuhri, he heard it from somebody else. And as by what Al-Bukhari said, and Yahya ibn Ma'in said, that hadith cannot be authentic. So what did Mu'adha say? Well, they say the hadith goes like this. عن معاذة قالت. And also it's worth mentioning here, this hadith comes in two forms. At one time, Mu'adha, the lady, the feminine of Mu'adh, is the one to have asked Aisha. And in another version, it is Aisha that spoke to another lady and Mu'adha overheard it. This is in a court of law. If you go to the court of law and the judge asks you, did you hear this? So in one statement, you say, I heard that from the person. And then in a second statement, you go, I heard the other person talking to somebody else. I overheard. I did not hear it directly. What's going to happen to your testimony? It's going to be just completely thrown away. But in our Islam, that's going to take us to Jannah and hellfire and all this kind of stuff. It's okay. Either she heard it from Aisha directly, or she heard Aisha talking to another woman directly, and she was the third party. No big deal. What matters to us is what was said. Actually, it's not. It matters who heard it. It's, as I said, it's not a good morning thing, or you lose 5 pounds. This is women that have not been praying for centuries, and women have been abused for centuries because of this ridiculous things that they have lied on Allah and His Messenger. Now, let's go to the version where Muslim says that Mu'adha is the one to have asked Aisha. Mu'adha said, I asked Aisha, فقلت ما بال الحائض تقضي الصوم ولا تقضي الصلاة. So Mu'adha is reported to ask Aisha, why is it that the menstruating woman makes up the fast but not the salat? Aisha inquired, أحرورية أنت؟ Are you a haruriya? Now, a haruriya is a name given to those, it's a small borough. It's called harura. Like in England, it's Ealing or whatever it is in your town. It's a small quarter or department. And it is in Al-Kufa, in Al-Iraq. In Al-Kufa, Al-Kufa was with Ali, radiallahu anhu. And they were against Muawiyah. These people were all the time against Muawiyah and Banu Umayyah. So Banu Abbas. So it was always a political turmoil area. So they would call anyone who's a troublemaker as what? Haruri. Just like I say, are you from the mafia? Or are you from Sicily, Italy? Straight away you understand it's mafia killing, things like that. So they say that Aisha said to her, Haruriyatun anti, are you of these people? And what she means, or what it is meant for the person who pushed this thing into this statement, is that you are a dissident. You are an outlaw from the government. You are the one who opposes the government, when in fact they oppose the tyrannical dynasty of Bani Umayyah and Bani Abbas that plagued Muslims for hundreds of years. But you see, that's how politics gets thrown into the hadith. But anyway, this label still exists today. In current days, three of Wahhabi sheikhs are going to be executed because they consider dissident, Khawarij, and they're going to be executed at the end of this Ramadan. Go figure. And these people have worked hard at establishing the Wahhabism in Saudi Arabia, but now they're just like always, the government uses these scholars and then gets rid of them. But anyhow, and then Mu'adha answers back, قُلْتُ لَسْتُ بِحَرُورِيَّةٍ وَلَكِنِّي أَسْأَلْ. I said, I am not a haruriya, I'm not a dissident, I'm not of these people, I'm just asking. قَالَتْ. Now it's Aisha saying, كَانَ يُصِيبُنَا ذَلِكَ We used to, or that used to happen to us. فَنُؤْمَرُ بِقَضَاءِ الصَّوْمِ We were ordered to make up the missed fast days. وَلَا نُؤْمَرُ بِقَضَاءِ الصَّلَاةِ And, but we were not ordered to make up for a salat. And this is in Muslim, Hadith Muslim. And this is the chief hadith upon which all other arguments, school of thoughts are built. Even the hadith of women, like in religion and the intellect is based on this hadith. But there is one truth that has or is being hidden from you. And this is known by all scholars worth a grain of salt in their thing. Scholars of either hadith or scholars that study, I don't speak about people who go to the University of Saudi Arabia. I'm talking about scholars that are specialized in the hadith. They know that Sahih Muslim comes second place to Al-Bukhari because in Muslim, in Sahih Muslim, what Muslim did, alayhi rahmatullah, he would mention weak hadiths and then he would point out as to why they are weak. In other words, in Sahih Muslim, you will find authentic hadiths and weak hadiths. But in the introduction that Imam Muslim wrote, alayhi rahmatullah, the author of this book, he said that when I mention a weak hadith, it is to mention the reason why that hadith is weak. Muslim is a student of Al-Bukhari. And as I said, he wrote an introduction unlike Al-Bukhari. Muslim wrote an introduction. And in that introduction, he specified that the hadith is weak and later on explains why. However, this particular hadith, even though Ma'mar is not an authentic, reliable narrator, Muslim did not point out to him as weak. And that made the scholars that came in that era and after him believe that Muslim, since he didn't do it, then the hadith must have been authentic in the eyes of Muslim. And since Muslim saw it authentic, then it is good enough for the Muslim nations for 1400 years to follow the point of view of one man. Allah al-Azim, this is calamity upon calamity. And these scholars, my sisters and my brothers, hide this truth from you. I'm going to give you now a hadith. So now the hadith of Ma'mar that he reported, again, as I said, Mu'adha on Asim to Ma'mar is a weak hadith, and that weak hadith is being applied today. Now, let me tell you another hadith that is hidden away from you, but this one is authentic. And this conversation is recorded between Ma'mar and his teacher Az-Zuhri. Remember, Az-Zuhri is the guy that Yahya ibn Ma'in and Al-Bukhari said, if Ma'mar tell you that he heard it from Az-Zuhri, that hadith is upright, is authentic. And if he speaks from someone else, then it is not. Well, now, Ma'mar not only is going to tell us a hadith from Az-Zuhri that is authentic, but he's going to say something that's going to shock you to the bones. This conversation is recorded by the great scholar of hadith, and his name is As-San'ali. And he's from Al-Yaman, Sana'a, Al-Yaman. And this guy was born in the year 126 Hijri calendar, i.e. he was born way before Yahya ibn Ma'in, alayhi rahmatullah, and died in the life of Al-Bukhari. So this guy is an absolute authority as well in the science of hadith, and his statement is authentic, approved by all scholars of hadith without any exclusion. Okay? Ma'mar was talking to Az-Zuhri. So this hadith is on Ma'mar, on Az-Zuhri. Ma'mar reported from Az-Zuhri, and again he said, so Ma'mar is asking Az-Zuhri, he goes, Al-Ha'idu taqdi sawm. So Ma'mar said to Az-Zuhri, the menstruating woman makes up her fasting missed days? And then Az-Zuhri said yes. And Ma'mar said to him, Amman, i.e., where did you hear this? On whose authority did you hear? You see, even the hadith of Aisha was unknown to Ma'mar to have said this one. So Ma'mar asks Az-Zuhri, where did you hear this from? Who told you this? And then Az-Zuhri says, and this is why you are not praying, my sisters, even though the Quran says you pray and you fast, but this is the reason why you don't fast and you don't pray. He says, Az-Zuhri said, هَذَا مَجْتَمَعَ النَّاسُ عَلَيْهِ. This is what people agreed upon. وَلَيْسَ فِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ نَجِدُ الْإِسْنَادِ. And the chain of narrators is not needed for everything. There you have it, my sisters. Women not fasting in Ramadan is only being practiced and followed and preached these days and forever because of a made-up agreement of people. We don't even have one single hadith where Rasulullah ﷺ said, women who are menstruated, don't fast and don't pray. We don't. It's just people inventing it. SubhanAllah, if I wanted to go to the hadith and sunnah route, kind of like I'm going to think as these people do, okay? I will ask this. How come the messenger of Allah, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, would curse a woman who touches her eyebrows, but not a woman who fasts? Who is more important, a woman who touches her eyebrows or a woman who doesn't fast? If the messenger can curse a woman who doesn't respond to her husband for sex, he doesn't speak about a menstruating woman telling her directly, don't fast? If making, subhanAllah, if he, the messenger, could make eating with the left hand haram, couldn't he speak something about women, menstruating women, not fast? And the list can go on and on and on. The reason why there is not a single hadith that prohibits women from fasting and praying is because it doesn't exist. The messenger of Allah would never, ever go against the Quran. Never. Allah would kill him. Allah would decapitate him. Allah would exterminate him like vermin. That's it. You've got no authority. My dear sisters and my brothers, this is extremely dangerous. Allah in the Quran has not excluded menstruating women from fasting. People tell me when I say this, they say, do you reject the sunnah? And say, why do you put all the eggs in the same basket? I don't reject the sunnah, but I also don't sell my Quran cheap. On judgment day, Allah is not going to ask me about my sunnah or the hadith. On judgment day, Allah is going to ask me about my Quran. The moment, if someone tells me something, I say, Allah didn't say that, I get this. Do you reject the sunnah then? Are you one of those people who follow the Quran only? Are you a Qur'ani? All these states, subhanAllah. Now following the Qur'an that Rasulullah ﷺ spent his life doing has become an insult in our times. Following the Qur'an alone, he's no longer sufficient in our times. If you tell somebody, if I can go on all my life, preach to people, Rasulullah ﷺ said, nobody's going to oppose me for not using the Qur'an. But the moment I push Qur'an, people say, and sunnah. And then again, they bring some issues. If it were not because of the sunnah, how would we know the number of rak'at we pray? And I tell you, because you say that question, is because you ignore totally how the salat was prescribed. You've got no clue, and you have no clue of the difference of opinions between scholars about the number of salats. Go figure now. And were it not that I am scared that people will suddenly find all, they will say, what is this Islam? I would tell you things, you will bang your head against the wall of what I know is hidden out there. So please, 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 I do not reject the sunnah, but I don't accept hadiths compiled 250 years at least later after the death of Rasulullah ﷺ, and the Quran has not spoken about them. To me, the other day someone sent me a hadith where the hadith is used to prove to me a point where initially I don't believe in that. It's like a Christian bringing to me the Bible to show me that Jesus is Son of God. Well, actually, initially, categorically, at the deep root, I don't believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and I don't believe it says that in the Bible, and it being in the Bible is not authentic. Would you believe that if someone brought to you the Bible? Would you bring it? Well, guess what? The same thing. Someone brings to me a hadith and he says, well, Rasulullah ﷺ said that there will be someone recline on their couch or their city, and when you bring a hadith, they will tell you, oh, we only accept all the bookings of Allah, and then they will tell you a whole story out of it. And I told somebody, you tell me a hadith to prove a hadith, show me in the Quran. Now, I want to get here to the manipulation techniques they use to the last few minutes, inshallah, manipulation techniques, and they use certain texts. I'm going to mention just two that keep surfacing every time you push, they try to push their agenda on you to obey Rasulullah. For your information, my sisters and my brothers, Allah did not command us to obey Rasulullah for him being a human being. We are to obey what the messenger brought, i.e. the Quran. That's why when he died, we no longer have to obey the Prophet Muhammad. That's it, he's dead, he's gone, bye-bye, finished, no more, until judgment day. Now the only one who is still alive amongst us is the Quran. And that's it. But to convince people that the messenger of Allah, and this is a total shirk that we live in, believed on the Salafists are deep in their necks into it, is that they say that Allah has given the Prophet Muhammad total authority to legislate equally to the Quran, i.e. what Allah says in the Quran is as equal as what the Muhammad says in a hadith. And this is a very, very nasty trick. So much so that scholars in their books of hadith, they say that actually the sunnah, the hadith, has got more authority than the Quran. And this is preached by the Salafis 100%. And I will cover this more when I deal about with the science of hadith. One chief argument that they bring from the Quran that we must obey Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam unconditionally is they use this, يُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ. He makes lawful for them the good things and prohibits for them the impure things. This ayah and the many like it are it's a small portion of an ayah extracted from a bigger ayah, taken away from the context in which it was revealed. And I will give this more inshallah when I start the series of hadith, because once I start the series of hadith, you'll be banging your head against the wall for one thing, for having ignored the Quran. Let me tell you this, Allah didn't give his envoy, the messenger, any authority to share powers with Allah. Allah لا يشرك في حكمه أحدا. Allah does not share his command with anybody. And this is in Surah Al-Kahf that Muslims read every Jum'ah, but yet they don't pay attention to it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he revealed the part of the above ayah that I mentioned, that he makes halal for them the good and makes haram for them the evil, he didn't say it as a general rule. Okay? Allah said it specifically in a context. On top of that, Allah had already decided what was tayyibat, what was good, and what was impure, what was al-khaba'it. Okay? If you go to a doctor, okay, I'm going to give you an example here, poison and fiber intake. If you told someone, my neighbor told me not to take poison, does this mean that your neighbor forbade you from drinking poison, or that they only reminded you of something that you already knew? And if you told somebody, my doctors told me to drink more water, does that mean that your dietitian or doctor ordered you to drink water, or just they reminded you of something you already knew? Well, يُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ. He makes lawful for them the good things and prohibits them from the evil or impure things is something that they already know. Look at this ayah and where it is situated. This ayah did not and does not talk about us. It did and still speaks about the people of the book, especially the Jews and Christians. In a million years, it never was, nor is for us. This ayah was mentioned while Allah spoke about Moses, his confrontation with the Pharaoh, the Egyptians, the exodus of the children of Israel, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was reminding the children of Israel about his favors, and how he supported them and helped them. He lent them few thousand favors. Okay? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them that he revealed the Torah to them, and in that Torah, Allah had put a reference to the coming coming of Muhammad. And as such, when Muhammad came to them, they should have been of the first ones to accept him, because they have it in their book. It's clear. And on top of that, what Muhammad is going to do, he is going to make halal for them the things that are good in life, but were prohibited on the children of Israel. Let me give you more example on this. Let me tell you a couple of things, and then we'll go to more in details on that, okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Quran is actually a book that supersedes and overrules over the Torah and the Injil. So whatever is in the Quran is the final version, is the final this updated version of the book of Allah. With this in mind, let us reread this ayah. Look what Allah says. الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الرَّسُولَ النَّبِيِّ الْأُمِّيِّ. Those who follow the messenger, the Gentile prophet. See, they translate into the prophet who doesn't read or write. No. النبي الأمي, the Jews would refer to anyone who is not a Jew as a Gentile. And in Arabic, they would call him Ummi. So Allah tells them that you follow the messenger, and that is the Gentile prophet. And he's talking to what? To not Gentile people. And then Allah says, الَّذِي يَجِدُونَهُ مَكْتُوبًا عِنْدَهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ. Whom, are in the description and the name and attributes of the Prophet Muhammad, they find written in what they have with them, i.e. the Torah and the Gospel. This messenger, okay, يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. This messenger, who Allah spoke to them about in the Gospel, and the Torah and the Gospel, will command them, not as يَأْمُرُهُمْ, لَيْسَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ, يَأْمُرُهُمْ will command them, not us, to do what is approved amongst them, but does not contradict the Quran. I will explain in a bit. And forbids them what is disapproved of. That's the direct translation of the terminology. And he makes halal for them the good things that are halal now, but were made haram on the children of Israel. Let me give you a pointer here. The Jews who strictly observe the Torah divide their kitchens into different sections for meat, for dairy, and with separate ovens, plates, utensils, depending on finance and all, but they all will follow, observe this law, each to their means. Also, certain foods, notably shellfish, like prawns and lobsters, things like that, are forbidden on the Jews. Meat and dairy cannot be combined, and few other things. But the Quran allows them all. So here, eating lobster or prawns is not haram for us, but to the children of Israel it is. So when the Prophet Muhammad will come to them, he will make what is already halal, halal on the Jews. You see what I mean? And, excuse me, other people like the Christians, they have no problem eating blood. Like you go to somebody and you go, oh, can I have my steak, but not done. When I was in the States, in California, they had this new diet where you eat raw meat, blood and all. Okay? So that is a khaba'ith. Then Rasulullah, according to the Quran, because the Quran prohibits eating of the blood, then it becomes haram. It's got nothing to do with us at all. And this is the sneaky, manipulative trick of the scholars of hadith and the sheikhs today. They are just like parrots. They would just keep reiterating, oh, يُحِلُ لَهُمْ طَيِّبَةُ حَرَمَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَاثُ. It's them, not us, it's them. So when the messenger of Allah was alive, he was asked to follow, they were asked, or we were asked to follow him because he was alive. But when he died, we follow the Quran, because the Quran is not dead. The Quran is the words of Allah. Only an alive can speak. And because Allah is always alive, the Quran is always alive. Muhammad is dead, his words cannot be alive. It's impossible. The laws of the Jews, my dear sisters and my brothers, follow these days are called the mitzvah or mitzvot, and there are 613. And the Jews really do cheat and trick around them, but they are very rough rules. If they follow the Quran, all these 613 would come down to about 20 of them. Subhanallah. Then Allah carries on, وَيَضَعُ عَنْهُمْ إِصْرَهُمْ, and relieves them, literally puts down their, from them, their burdens. The Jews and the Christians have burdens around them. وَالْأَغْلَالَ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ, and the shackles that bound them. And they are found in the Torah. You know, such a disobedient child is executed, is killed. Women go, the masses, the woman is completely isolated. The niqab and the way woman wears the hijab, all these are in the Torah, not. And then Allah says, فَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِهِ, as for those who believe in him, in Muhammad, وَعَزَّرُوهُ, and dignify him, and he's talking about the Jews and Christians here, وَنَصَرُوهُ, and support him. And then comes the punch, and then Allah says, وَاتَّبَعُوا النُّورَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ مَعَهُ, and followed the light, i.e. the Qur'an that was descended with him. Allah did not ask them to follow him. You see, they dignify Muhammad, they support Muhammad in his life, but when it comes to following, Allah says, you follow the Qur'an, the light. He didn't say, وَاتَّبَعُوهُ. He didn't. And then Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ, those are or will be the successful. And this is in Surah Al-A'raf, Surah number 7, Ayah 105, 157. See, the making of halal and haram have nothing to do with us, but rather the people of the book. Our sheikhs, our scholars are big liars. The righteous predecessors is a myth. It's a manipulative tools that they have used for years. The second chief ayah that you will also encounter is the one when they say, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا, and whatever the messenger has given you, take it. Whatever he forbids you, refrain from it. And this is in Surah 59. And that's it. They won the argument, right? Yet, when you look at this portion from the Quran and the context where the ayah existed, you will find that it has a complete different meaning than what these people manipulate you with. In Surah Al-Hashr, again it's Ayah 59, when Allah, in the whole surah, Allah talks about a confrontation that took place between the children of Israel, a tribe, Bani Nadir, a tribe of them, and the Muslims at that time, or the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These people were living in Khaybar, outside the city of Medina. They were once exiled from Al-Medina for a big betrayal. They were really traitors and all that kind of stuff. And then they did something evil, and then the confrontation time came. Prophet Muhammad takes the armies and they go, and what happened was, Khaybar was a very robust fortress. The Jews was completely barricaded in there. Muslims could not get there for days, weeks. They could not get there. And then finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped them and they won and they opened those fortresses and Muslims get into that. This is like a big story told in few words. Okay? Now, in Al-Quran, Allah talks about two things, Al-Ghanima and Al-Fayya. Al-Ghanima happens after you fight. The fight takes place, people die and all that kind of stuff, and then you win the battle and you take the spoils of war. These spoils of war, when you take them, you take one-fifth of them to Allah and His Messenger to be used, and then the rest of the other four-fifths will be divided between the soldiers. Before, because they did not have an organized army, how they did it was like this. A knight that had a horse and spear and sword would get far more than a knight that, say, has a horse and a spear. Would get more than a knight who had a sword and a camel. And a knight that has a spear and two swords and a strong horse get far more than someone who walks on their foot. It's just the way, because the knight invests more in the fight. So the division of the spoils of war was different. But al-fay' is when you go to a battle, but you don't enter into a fight. The enemy surrenders and you take take their goods. That is a gift from Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here did not make this into the fifth and the fourth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left it to the messenger to decide, and Allah told the messenger exactly how to spend that wealth. Now, some of the companions that took their horses and spears, they were expecting a battle and to get more. But when they got to Khaybar, to the city of Khaybar, there was no fight. So actually all the investment was of nothing. So they ended up getting the goods, the loot, but there was no fight. So they're not going to get a lot of money. When the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ started dividing the wealth, these people were not happy. And Allah was talking to them. Listen to the ayah that you've been manipulated with for decades, and the rest of Muslims for centuries, and many more centuries to come. Muslims are going to be manipulated with this, and unless they open their eyes and go back to the Quran. See what Allah says. مَا أَثَاءَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْقُرَىٰ. Whatever, no battle, spoils of war. So there was no battle, but Allah gives them the loot. Okay? Allah has passed on to His messenger from the people of the towns. So you see here, the goodies of that surrender was given to the messenger, not divided amongst the believer, given to the messenger. This is important. From the Ahl al-Qura, the people of the tribes, the cities of Khaybar. And then Allah says, فَلِلَّهِ وَلِلْرَّسُولِ وَلِذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ. The division of such wealth should be done as follows. Allah, and this is for Islam promotion, and then, and for the messenger, his wages and whatever. That's why Rasulullah took a piece of land for him from that. And then Allah says, and for the kinsmen, from the relatives, members of the household of Rasulullah, and then to the orphans, the needy, and the wayfarer. That wealth, the armies had absolutely not a thing in it, except if someone was poor, then they would get money because they are poor, not because they were of the soldiers. And as I said, people start getting angry. Then Allah says, this division is in force. كَيْ لَا يَكُونَ دُولَةً بَيْنَ الْأَغْنِيَاءِ بَيْنَكُمْ. So that it may not, i.e. this wealth, circulate only between the rich among you. Because many people want to fight for money. Not all of them want for the sake of Allah. Now these people that didn't get any wealth start, and Rasulullah gave them a little bit as wages, because of Allah, you remember the portion for Allah to promote Islam. These people went with the intention of fighting, so Rasulullah paid them a little money. People were not happy. Hypocrites, absolutely not. They resented it and they started complaining. And at that time, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ. Whatever He gave you as wages from that faith, from that what Allah bestowed upon you, take it. And what He stopped you from, what He stopped you from taking, وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْ أَخْدِهِ فَانْتَهُ. And whatever He stopped you from taking, the other wealth, stop it, don't take it. And then Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ. And do what Allah commands. إِنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Indeed, Allah is severe in punishment. See, it's got nothing to do with following the sunnah or accepting hadith or this brainwashing techniques. It's got to do with a particular thing that happened at one moment of history in the life of Rasulullah ﷺ, and that's that. But our righteous predecessors, those cheat, manipulative government scholars, agents, they took portion of the Quran from the context in which they were mentioned, and they use them to control us and control us. And the best at it are Salafists. These people, it's unbelievable how much they have messed up Al-Quran. And this is how we have all been and still are cheated out of the book of Allah. My dear sisters and my brothers, it's sad to see that the Quran is maliciously used to give authority to the Hadith, then they use the Quran as means to give authority to a human collected artwork 300 years later, then the Quran becomes second to the Hadith. They did worse than the Jews or Christians did to the Bible or the Gospel. Our problem these days is that for centuries, the Quran pages which contain Islam have been covered up with millions of pages of tafsir, of Hadith, of Sheikh opinions, views of scholars and school of thought, and etc. So much so that these human-made covering pages have taken precedence over the Quran. So much so that ask any Muslim about anything in Islam and tell them don't mention a Hadith. If I ask you what's the ruling on that thing, I don't want you to mention a Hadith or a saying of scholar, I want you to say it from the Quran. Okay? And watch their behavior. They'll be able to answer 2-3 questions and that's that. Allah is totally really non-existent in the Islam we have today. And when I mean Allah, I mean the Quran. In our times as ever, it is a crime, a huge, non-forgivable crime to prioritize the Quran. Can you believe that? So much so that if someone tells you the Hadith, again, being the messenger or whatever, and you say, oh, hang on, what does Allah say this in that? They will actually frown upon you. They will straight away give you a label. They will straight away put you in some place. But they all forget, for its worth, you can believe in all the Sunnah you want. You can also believe in all the Hadith you want. You can follow and believe in all the righteous predecessors, whatever you want. But on Judgment Day, you will only be asked about how have you done with the Quran and the Quran alone. Listen to the threat that's awaiting us. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِ. And whoever veers or deviates away from my dhikr. Dhikr is a comprehensive name for the Torah, the Gospel, and the Quran. It's these three books. The Jews that are deviate from the Torah, the Christians that deviate from the Gospel, and the Muslims that deviate from the Quran. On Judgment Day, or any other book descended by Allah, on Judgment Day, Allah says here before Judgment Day, فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا. He will surely have, or she will surely have, a stressful and anxious life. Stress today is causing problems to the entire earth, and that is a promise of Allah. And bunk is narrow. Even you can be in a castle, but you don't have the serenity, the peace in the heart and the mind, and you feel it's anyhow. Stress and anxiety really define the point here. And then Allah says this is in this life. And then on Judgment Day, وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. And we shall raise him up blind on Resurrection Day. Imagine today you watch, you look with your eyes. Judgment Day you're completely blind, you don't see. And then the interesting will happen. قال, this person who will be raised as blind will say, رَبِّي لِمَا حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرٌ. My Lord, why have you raised me blind when I had sight in the world? Allah says to him, قال, Allah answers back saying, كذلك أتتك آياتنا فنسيتها. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so it must be because that you're blind here in this life, because our ayat, if it's the Quran, it's the ayat from the Quran, and the Bible, it's the Bible, and you get the idea, and came to you, but you deferred, you retarded, you postponed them, you didn't pay attention to them, you didn't believe in them, you didn't act on them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. And so it must also pass today that you shall also be deferred, retarded, and postponed. See, no mention of al-Bukhari, no mention of Muslim, no Sunnah, no Hadith, no Ibn Taymiyyah, no Ibn Baz, no Ibn Uthaymeen, no Islam QA, no Munajjid, no Fawzan, nothing at all. It's gonna be you and Allah, the Quran. It's gonna be you, the Torah, and that's it. It's gonna be you and the Gospel, and that's it. And every time you defer or retard or postpone a law from the book of Allah for something else, then get ready for a resurrection in total blindness. Today, Muslims, we have a huge problem. Allah in the Quran says, I think I should stop here and carry on in next one because I still have to cover the zakat. And I'll see you in part 4, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.